Shalom Aleichem. My name is Rabbi Adam Dubin, and I work for the RCA in New York City. So this week's Parsha, as we know, is Parsha's Lech Lecha. And there's a variety of things, of course, that we're very familiar with, including, of course, the very beginning of the Parsha, where Hashem tells Avram Avinu, who we're briefly introduced to, at the end of last week's Parsha, to go out from the land of your father. And again, a lot of what happens in between Parshas Noach and Parshas Lech Lecha in that area is a midrash. But then we go to a few psukim later, really a few prakim later, and we see it's a perik Yud Dalet Pasuk Aleph, where it says, "Vayhi b'mei Amraphel Melch Shinar." Aryuch Melech Elsar Kidlaimer Melech Elam Vesedu Melech Goyim. That it happened in the days of Amraphel, the king of Shinar, Aryuch, the king of Elasar, Kidlaimer, the king of Elam, and Tidal, king of Goyim. So that brings, of course, very classic question of who was Amraphel? So Rashi in the Pasuk says that Amraphel was actually Nimrod, who said Amar to Avram, to fall into the fiery furnace. Again, as we end up to learn from the Midrash between Parshas Noach and Parshas Lech Lecha. Now the Gemara in Maseches Erevin has a different opinion. The Gemara says that this was the dispute between Rav and Shmuel. Rav said that his real name was Nimrod, but that he was also called Amraphel because he said the command that caused Avram to fall into the fiery furnace. And Shmuel said his real name was, in fact, Amraphel, but he was also called Nimrod because he caused the entire world to rebel, Shehem Hom Mori, against Hashem. Right, the Maharsha, the Parshas Noach, says the Torah says that Cush, the father of Nimrod, he started to be a rebel in the land, and that is that he became the first person to fight in wars. Since the war between the four kings and the five kings is the first war that we have reported in the Torah, and the first war that ostensibly occurred in the world, it's logical to assume that the Torah is now filling in more information about what was stated earlier. Therefore, the two names of Nimrod and Amraphel must be referring to the same person, one being his real name and the other the acquired name. Taking a closer look at this about the dispute between Rav and Shmuel, it's a reflection of their different approaches to Limud HaTorah. Rav preferred a straightforward study of Mishnah where the ideas are self-explanatory and can be taken at face value. And we see this from learning and Gemara Maseches Baba Basra. Whereas Shmuel favored the more complex and analytical approach that we refer to as Pilpul, where arguments are refuted and honed and fine-tuned through focused applications of the mind, as we see the Gemara Maseches Chagiga. Similarly, Rav tended to interpret the pasuk at its simple pshat, its face value, translating the words of the Torah literally, whereas Shmuel would analyze each statement of the Torah more logically, adapting the interpretation to ensure its contextual consistency. With that in mind, we can explain their differing opinions to our pasuk. When Rav read the pasuk in Parshas Noach that Cush fathered Nimrod, he started to be a rebel in the land. He took the Torah's words at face value. That was that Nimrod was the actual name of Cush's son. On reading our pasuk, Rav discovered that Nimrod could also be referring to Amraphel. So he explained how the name Amraphel was the Torah's alternative descriptive name. He was also called Amraphel because he said to Abraham, "Fall into the fiery furnace." On the other hand, Shmuel rejected this face value, the simple pshat approach, and analyzed the psukim according to their context. So therefore, the Torah stated in Parshas Noach that Cush fathered Nimrod. He started to be a rebel in the land. Shmuel was struck with this following problem. It said, this section of Parshas Noach lists at length all the descendants of Noach. When listing all the other names, the Torah tells us nothing about their personalities. Only when we read about Nimrod does Hashem interject and say he started to rebel against Hashem in the land. He was a powerful trapper of people's minds, turning them against the Kodesh Baruch Hu. And therefore, it is said about the rebellious people that they are like Nimrod, a powerful trapper against Hashem. And this sudden change of pattern troubled Shmuel. Why did the Torah tell us only about Nimrod's personality? Shmuel therefore came to the logical conclusion to his problem that in contrast to all the other names that preceded his, Nimrod was not in fact his actual name, but rather a name that the Torah used to describe his personality. And this explains why after telling us that his name was Nimrod, the Torah digressed to tell us about how he acquired the name, because he caused the world to rebel against Hashem. Therefore, when reading our pasuk in Parshas Lech Lecha, Shmuel understood that Amraphel must have been Nimrod's real name, since we had been told only about his acquired name in Parshas Noach. Now, we see all over the importance of understanding words, names. They all have meaning. Unlike what Shakespeare famously quotes, "The rose by any other name would smell as sweet," we understand that when Hashem uses a word, uses a name, that it has real value. There's something really to it. And so it's important to understand what everything means. And to just mention briefly, this study, this learning of taking everything into account is something that I learned from my Rebbe, the Moshe David Tendler, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, who, as we know, was Nifter on Shmini Atzeres this year. And one of the things that Rabbi Tendler always would say is that you can always learn something from the Midrash. There's always something to teach. And so all of his drushes really were based out of the Midrash, as he will often say, that they're the same names that you find in Midrash, you're going to find in the Gemara as well. Again, everything that's recorded, everything is important to understand what the meaning between the lines are. The meaning between the words is so important, and something that we don't always understand at a simple pshat level, even as we try to delve deeper. So it's a lesson that I try to learn from my Rebbe, that we should end up to try our best to read in between the lines, to do our homework, as he used to say, to not just look for the easy out, but to see how everything connects. And through studying Midrash, it helps us to hone our minds in a way that even the study of straight Gemara can't. So I wish everyone a good Shabbos. Zayge Benchtov.